Hi everyone, welcome back. So today I'm going to continue from yesterday's lecture. So today we will be covering mainly the catabolism of amino acid. Though the earlier lecture also part of these particular catabolism, we will focus mainly today on the of the carbon skeleton of these standard amino acids. As we know, these 20 standard amino acids can be catabolized mostly into one of the intermediates of the TCA cycle. So if they enter the TCA cycle through one of the intermediates, then many of them can be converted to oxaloacetate. And if oxaloacetate is there, then oxaloacetate can be used for glucose synthesis. So most of these amino acids are glucogenic. There is only two amino acids which is strictly ketogenic, that is leucine and lysine. And among these also lysine is highly ketogenic. Okay, so today we need to see how these groups of amino acids are converted to the final product which enters the TCA cycle mainly, and also the ketogenic amino acids. Yes, you see here these two groups of amino acids are ketogenic, but many of them are also glucogenic. As I have been saying, only lysine and leucine being strictly ketogenic. So further, before going into the details of the catabolism of each of these amino acids, let's see some of the cofactors which are involved in amino acid catabolism. As we know, cofactors or coenzymes are very important in many of the enzyme catalyzed reaction. They help the amino enzymes carrying out a particular function. So here in amino acid catabolism, particularly three cofactors are important: tetrahydrofolate, S-adenosylmethionine, and biotin. But there is one common factor, one common property of all these three cofactors, that they are involved in one carbon transfer reaction. Here one carbon transfer means transfer of a group which contains one carbon. So for example, biotin is involved in transfer of carbon dioxide, which contains only one carbon. For biotin, we have already come across one of its role in the previous classes. For example, it is involved in the carboxylation of pyruvate to form oxaloacetate during the gluconeogenesis pathway. So we won't go into the details of this biotin. Today we are going to see more details regarding trihydrofolate and S-adenosyl methionine. And these two cofactors are used for transferring one carbon groups, but S-adenosyl methionine is particularly used for transferring methyl group, whereas tetrahydrofolate can be used for transferring many other one carbon groups. So we'll see that tetrahydrofolate is more versatile than S-adenosyl methionine. So let's see first the tetrahydrofolate. So tetrahydrofolate is synthesized from folate, which is an essential and for vitamin. Tetrahydrofolate can transfer one carbon groups like methyl groups, primary alcohol groups, and aldehyde groups. Because of its ability to involve in the transfer of different one carbon groups, they are used in a wide variety of metabolic reactions, not only in the metabolism of carbon skeleton of amino acids. And the carbon of these groups comes from serine, which is again an amino acid. And this is logical because since they are involved in the metabolism of amino acid, is going to remove or carry one of the carbon from one of the amino acids, but specifically from serine. There are different forms of this tetrahydrofolate, which are mostly interconvertible to one another. For example, one form can be used to carry methyl group, one primary alcohol group, and another aldehyde group. So this is the structure of tetrahydrofolate. So these cofactor contains in itself a glutamate residue, a para-aminobenzoic group, and a cyclic structure called 6-methyl-taurine. And these two nitrogen, which is at carbon number 5 and 10, are mainly responsible for carrying the carbon groups. See what are the different forms. Let's see what are the different forms of these tetrahydrofolate. As we have seen, these tetrahydrofolate has different forms, and these different forms are used to carry different forms of one carbon groups. In its most oxidized, most reduced form, there is the methyl group is carried by N5-methyl tetrahydrofolate. And primary alcohol group is carried by N5, N10, methylene tetrahydrofolate. And as you see here, the carbon which is used for transferring from used for transferring comes from 7. So if you remove this primary alcohol group and replace by an hydrogen, then 7 becomes glycine, and this group hydroxyl group leaves as water, whereas this ethylene group is linked to this N5 and N10. So it is called N5 N10 methylene tetrahydrofolate. Now this N5 N10 methylene tetrahydrofolate is converted or reversibly converted to this N5 N10 methanol tetrahydrofolate, and this particular intermediate can again be reversibly converted to this N5-formino tetrahydrofolate, which can carry the most oxidized form of one carbon group, that is aldehyde group. You see here, these all are interconvertible. So these two are the main forms which carries this aldehyde group. Instead of forming these forms from N5, N10 methylene tetrahydrofolate, these forms can also be synthesized directly from tetrahydrofolate by another enzyme which requires ATP. That's why it is a synthetase enzyme. Okay, you don't need to worry about all these structures, but you should remember why this particular cofactor is a very versatile carrier of one carbon groups. Okay, let's come to S-adenosyl methionine. When a reaction needs a methyl group, then S-adenosyl methionine is a better donor of methyl group. Although we have seen tetrahydrofolate can also carry methyl group, but S-adenosyl methionine is the preferred cofactor for methyl transfer in most of the biological reaction. Yes, even here this methyl which is linked to S-adenosyl methionine is 1000 times more reactive than that of the tetrahydrofolate methyl group. So in most of the reaction where there is transfer of methyl groups, S-adenosyl methionine will be used as a methyl group donor. And as the name indicates, S-adenosyl methionine consists of a methionine residue. And another part of the molecule, adenosine, coming from ATP. So S-adenosyl methionine is synthesized from ATP and methionine. once it has donated its methionine, sorry, methyl group, this S-adenosyl methionine will be regenerated using the methyl group from N5-methyltetrahydrofolate. So it seems like N5-methyltetrahydrofolate is the ultimate donor, but since it cannot take part in most of the reactions where methyl group is transferred, it transfers its methyl group to methionine, and methionine, S-adenosyl methionine, is used as the donor for this methyl group. So let's see the cycle of this methyl group. This is a part of the S-adenosyl methionine. You see here, this is methionine. So methionine contains a sulfur atom, and along and the methyl group is attached to the sulfur atom. So during the formation of S-adenosyl methionine, methionine reacts with ATP. So the reaction starts when the lone pair of electron attacks the carbon number 5 of the ribose sugar of this adenosine. So there is formation of a covalent bond between the sulfur of the methionine with that of the carbon number 5 of the ribose sugar. So since this carbon cannot have five covalent bond, this bond will be broken down, and the electron which was used to form this bond will be given to this, will be accepted by this oxygen. So this will leave as triphosphate, but it doesn't leave as triphosphate. It is further broken down into one pyrophosphate, inorganic pyrophosphate, and one inorganic phosphate. And this reaction is catalyzed by this methionine adenosyl transferase. So this is the S-adenosyl methionine, which is used as the methyl group donor in many of the reaction. One good example where it acts as the methyl group donor is in the methylation of DNA after its replication. And methylation is a very important post-replication event. If there is any problem in methylation, then the DNA might be having mutation also, or the resulting DNA will be prone to attack by various enzymes, particularly nucleases. So this S-adenosyl methionine, after donating its methyl group to a receptor, so simply represented by this R, which is a receptor for this methyl group. So there are many methyl transferase enzymes which transfer methyl group from S-adenosyl methionine to them. That is the receptor for this methyl group. Once the methyl group has been transferred, now this methionine devoid of this methyl group is called homocysteine. That's why its name is now es adenosine homocysteine. In order to regenerate this S-adenosyl methionine, this S-adenosyl methionine is further hydrolyzed by anhydrolase, which removes the adenosine part of S-adenosyl homocysteine. So the adenosine is removed. So only the homocysteine remains. Now, in order to form this S-adenosyl methionine, the reaction requires methionine. So methionine is regenerated from homocysteine through this methionine synthase enzyme, in which this N5-methyl tetrahydrofolate is the methyl group donor. So this methyl group is now transferred to this sulfur, and in this way the methionine is regenerated. If there is methionine again, then it will react with another ATP to form new S-adenosyl methionine. So the cycle will go on. If there is no deficiency of this ultimate methyl group donor, that is N5-methyl tetrahydrofolate, and we can see the importance of this vitamin called folic acid also. Okay, we are now coming to the catabolism of the carbon skeleton of the amino acids. So here you will see the amino acids which are catabolized to an end product which can be used to produce ketone bodies. So any amino acid which can produce acetyl-CoA or acetyl-CoA can be used to produce ketone bodies. So many of the steps are not included here. So this is just to give you an overall picture how different amino acids can give this acetoacetal-CoA. So on this side you see here two aromatic amino acids, phenylalanine and tyrosine, and one branch chain amino acid, that is leucine. These three amino acids can be converted to acetoacetal-CoA. Phenylalanine is first converted to tyrosine, then through various reactions it is converted to acetoacetate. And leucine can also be converted to acetoacetate after going through six steps, and ultimately will form the acetoacetal-CoA. Now here we will be discussing more detail regarding the catabolism of phenylalanine. And the catabolism of phenylalanine overlaps with the degradation of tyrosine also, because you see the structure of these two amino acids, they differ only in the presence of this hydroxyl group. So during the degradation of phenylalanine, this first converted to tyrosine. So tyrosine and phenylalanine almost will have the same degradation pathway or catabolic pathway. And on this side there is this one aromatic amino acid, tryptophan and lysine and alanine. As I have said in our as you have seen in the earlier slides, lysine is strictly ketogenic. The end products of the catabolism of lysine cannot be used for the net synthesis of glucose. That's why it is strictly ketogenic. Whereas tryptophan, phenylalanine can be used for net synthesis of glucose also. So these two, both tyrosine and phenylalanine, including tryptophan, they are both ketogenic and glucogenic. So lysine ultimately, after many steps, is converted to S2-acetyl-CoA, and it is very easy to see that S2-acetyl-CoA can be broken down into 2-acetyl-CoA. Now, during the initial degradation of tryptophan, it releases alanine, which is again another amino acid. But the amino acid alanine can be easily converted to pyruvate, and if there is pyruvate, then pyruvate can be converted to oxaloacetate, and that oxaloacetate can be used to synthesize, used for synthesis of glucose. These alanine from tryptophan is coming from this portion of tryptophan. So without the ring structure, the remaining part of tryptophan is nothing but alanine. Again, another branch amino acid, that is isoleucine, is also converted to acetyl-CoA and propionyl-CoA. So this propionyl-CoA can be converted to one of the intermediate of TCA cycle, that is succinyl-CoA. So isoleucine is a glucogenic amino acid, although it can also give acetyl-CoA. So so far we have seen that we are emphasizing on the end products of these amino acids. With respect to TCA cycle, that means most of the amino acids are degraded to one of the intermediates of the TCA cycle. But some of the amino acids are degraded to be used for the synthesis of various active molecules. For example, here tryptophan is a precursor of serotonin, which is a neurotransmitter. You will come to know what are neurotransmitter in fourth semester. For the time being, neurotransmitters are chemical synthesized by neurons, which on release will bind to other neurons or other cells, which can be acting similarly to that of hormones. There is another hormone, but it is a plant hormone, that is indole acetate. Then tryptophan is also used to produce niacin, and niacin is precursor of NAD and NADP. And we know that NAD and NADP are very important coenzymes. They are involved in the transfer of two electrons. So we'll be coming to the detailed catabolism or degradation pathway of phenylalanine. And in this pathway, the pathway of tyrosine degradation will also be overlapped. We are going to see more detail regarding this degradation of these particular phenylalanine because many genetic defects were discovered for the first time in human, particularly in this particular pathway. So historically, this pathway is important to biochemists and to some extent to molecular biologists also. And you see here, each of these degradation steps requires an enzyme. If any of these enzymes are not functional, it may be due to mutation or maybe because of some other genetic defects. It will cause different types of metabolic diseases. So let's see briefly that this degradation pathway. Phenylalanine is first converted to tyrosine. Now, as I have said, phenylalanine differs from tyrosine in the presence in the only in this particular hydroxyl group. So if you put one hydroxyl group here, then it becomes tyrosine. So if this hydroxyl group is to be attached, then there must be a source of this oxygen, an electron and proton. So in this reaction, oxygen serves as the source of this oxygen of this hydroxyl group and the electron and proton from the NADH. So this NADH, which is a reduced form, is converted to oxidized form. Now you see here this oxygen molecule being these two atoms of oxygen. One has gone here, so another oxygen molecule will come out as water molecule. And this reaction is catalyzed by the enzyme phenylalanine hydroxylase. So the absence of activity of this particular enzyme will cause this metabolic disease called phenylketonuria. And phenylketonuria may also be caused not only by the absence of this particular enzyme, functional form of this enzyme, but even when there is deficiency of these coenzymes also, for example, there is no tetrahydrobiopterin or NADH, then this reaction cannot occur. So in that case also, it will lead to phenylketonuria. Okay, coming to the next step. In the next step, tyrosine is converted to para-hydroxyphenylpyruvate. If you see these two structures, it is tyrosine and para-hydroxyphenylpyruvate. The difference in these two molecules is this. Para-hydroxyphenylpyruvate has this carbonyl group here, that is, in case of tyrosine, is this alpha amino group. So, if this amino group is transferred to a keto acid, then this keto acid, that is alpha ketoglutarate, will become glutamate. So, tyrosine. Alpha amino group of tyrosine has been transferred to alpha ketoglutarate forming glutamate. So this carbon will become keto group. So this is a typical aminotransferase reaction. And the newly formed keto acid is para-hydroxyphenylpyruvate. Why it is called para-hydroxy? Because you see here, ortho meta para. So, para-hydroxy, and this is what? Phenyl. So, para-hydroxyphenyl, and this portion is pyruvate. So para-hydroxyphenylpyruvate. In the next reaction, this para-hydroxyphenylpyruvate is converted to homozentisate, another intermediate of this pathway. And it is formed by this para-hydroxyphenylpyruvate dioxygenase. You see here the difference between these two structure. So in this reaction, what is occurring is that this carboxyl group goes as carbon dioxide. One of the oxygen is used to hydroxylate the phenyl group, and another oxygen will come here to form a new carboxyl group. Since this particular enzyme is able to use up the two atoms of the oxygen, it is called dioxygenase, putting two oxygen atoms into the product. So that's why it's called dioxygenase. Since it is putting the oxygen to para-hydroxyphenylpyruvate, its name is called para-hydroxyphenylpyruvate dioxygenase. In the next step, this homozentisate is converted to next intermediate called malyl acetoacetate. Now this malyl acetoacetate is formed from homozentisate using another oxygen molecule. So this enzyme is also likely to be a dioxygenase, as you see here. So it puts another two oxygen into the substrate, forming the product. While putting these two oxygen atoms, the ring structure of this homogeneity set is open, so forming this cyclic intermediate called malyl acetoacetate. These four carbons are highlighted here, as you see here. So this carbon must be this one. So this hydroxyl group will be converted to this keto group. And next we have these two carbons. And the methylene group is there because of the double bond. Then finally this carbon will be oxidized to carboxyl group. So because of the formation of a double bond, there is the release of one proton. One proton is released here. Let's see why it is called malyl acetoacetate. If you see this particular portion, this is one acetate, this is another acetate. So this is called acetoacetate. But you see here again, if this carbon is considered as a carboxylic group, then it is malic acid. So the name of this intermediate is malyl acetoacetate. In the next step, this malyl acetoacetate is isomerized to another acid called fumarate. So malic acid and fumaric acid are isomers. Here, in case of malic acid, the two hydrogens attached to the carbon involved in the double bond formation are on the both sides. That is in the cis configuration. Whereas in case of this fumarate, the two hydrogens are in the trans configuration. So structurally they are same, but the arrangement of these two configuration of these two protons are different. So they are structural isomers. So malyl acetoacetate is isomerized to fumaryl acetoacetate. Then the fumaryl acetoacetate is broken down into two parts, two products. The other part, as we know, must be fumarate, and the other part is the acetoacetate. So this is the hydrolysis enzyme, that's why it requires water. So from phenylalanine you have two products, fumarate and acetoacetate. Now this fumarate can be converted to malate, then malate can be converted to oxaloacetate, and that oxaloacetate can be used to produce glucose. So part of the phenylalanine is used for, can be used for glucose synthesis. The other part is acetoacetate. Can be used to produce ketone bodies or acetoacetal CoA. Acetoacetate can also be considered as a ketone body. Yeah, this acetoacetate is converted to acetoacetal CoA using the coenzyme from succinyl CoA. So succinyl CoA is converted to succinate as it has transferred its coenzyme to the acetoacetyl group. So in this way, phenylalanine can be broken down to fumarate and acetoacetyl CoA. You see, I have highlighted the importance of this particular enzyme, and the absence of the activity of the other remaining enzyme also may also result to various metabolic diseases. Mutation or deficiency of tyrosine aminotransferase will lead to tyrosinemia and there are three types of tyrosinemia as you see here. Tyrosinemia 1, tyrosinemia 2. Why it's called tyrosinemia? Because if these reactions do not occur, what will happen? There will be accumulation of tyrosine. So the concentration of tyrosine in the blood will increase. That's why it is called tyrosinemia. So deficiency of these three enzymes may lead to tyrosinemia. Another metabolic disease is alkaptonuria. Occurs when there is no functional homoxanthate 1,2-dioxygenase enzyme. This is called alkaptonuria because absence of this enzyme will lead to the increased concentration of homoxanthate, and this homoxanthate will be converted to other intermediates which are found in the urine. So whenever you see this suffix nuria, that means it refers to urine. If it is nemia, then it refers to blood or plasma. So we are going to see the problem with respect to one of these metabolic disorder, that is phenylketonuria. As we have seen, phenylketonuria occurs when there is no functional phenylalanine synthase. So if that particular reaction do not occur, if there is no phenylalanine hydroxylase, then phenylalanine cannot be converted to tyrosine. So there must be accumulation of phenylalanine. So what the system tries is that it diverts the phenylalanine to some other products since that particular enzyme is no more functional. So through a aminotransferase reaction, phenylalanine can transfer its amino group to pyruvate, which is a keto acid. Then this pyruvate will become alanine. So the remaining portion is this phenylpyruvate, and this phenylpyruvate can be further converted to phenylacetate, and in another reaction, phenylpyruvate can be converted to phenyllactate. So when there is phenylketonuria, there will be this phenylacetate will be found in the urine. That's why it's called ketonuria. So what is the, so we may ask, if this particular reaction doesn't occur, what will happen to the system? It has many problems. There will be impairment of neurological development. Ultimately, it will lead to inability to deficits.
Yeah.